Greetings, everybody, and welcome to this week's community check-in with Councilwoman Sihelnik for District 1. I'm always excited to be able to touch base with you, even if it's through this platform, just to know how you're doing, just to get some updates from great people in our community who are providing resources and information and activities during this time when we can't be together. So I hope everybody's enjoying today. It's a beautiful sunny day today. And much like yesterday, where there was some hail and rain and sun all at the same time, today is looking just a little bit more mild. Today I have three really great guests with me, always trying to reflect on people from the neighborhoods and the diversity of the 18th Ward and our South of Penn, which make up District 1. We also have a perspective from a local business owner. We have the director of our Reading Recreation Commission with us. And we also have the director of the Community Development Department from the City of Reading. So always bringing a bunch of different perspectives to you so that you can really get a nice picture of what is happening and what is going on in your community with your community members while we are all at a stay-at-home order and while we are practicing physical distancing. So I'd like to start today with something and someone that I've been hearing a lot about. So normally during this time of year, programs are gearing up for the summer. We're thinking about what we're gonna do. We're signing up for our camps. We're eagerly playing outside in the spring weather. And there is an entity that really has been affected greatly by being able to provide those resources to you, and that's our Reading Recreation Commission. And so today I'd like to invite Daphne Clare to talk to us a little bit about what's going on in her world, what is happening, what message she has to share with us in terms of updates and what we can be doing and how to stay engaged with them even though we're at home. So Daphne, I'd like to welcome you on the show. Are you still with us?
I am. Thanks, Lucine. Hi, everybody. My name is Daphne Clare. I'm the executive director for the Reading Recreation Commission. We oversee recreation programming in the city of Reading in partnership with the city and the Reading School District. So it's a very interesting time right now as we have kind of shifted our focus from providing recreation programming at our facilities to providing food. And so while we have a food service program that we operate all year long, our deliverables have just about tripled since all of this began with COVID-19. And since March 15th, we have served over 35,000 meals to kids in the city of Reading, in addition to distributing 56,000 pounds of food to families in our community, including a lot of senior citizens in our neighborhoods, especially around the Third and Spruce Recreation Center. So it's really interesting times. I wore yellow today and hope that we move into the yellow phase sooner than later. But we are doing our best to keep connected to our kids. We see a lot of them in person every day when they come to get meals and say hi to counselors and their teachers. We are also connecting through Facebook. We're putting up pictures, letting kids know what's going on, posting some craft ideas. We're also handing out craft packets at our food sites occasionally and some puzzles and things like that, so things to keep busy at home. We're encouraging people to, walk around your parks. Don't stay in your house completely, but just practice social distancing of 6 feet. But we have plenty of nice parks in the city to walk, and we hope that you enjoy some fresh air and just do that responsibly. We are looking forward to having all of you back. We miss you terribly. We miss the kids, everybody. We're just heartbroken that we're not seeing your faces here at the rec center. So we hope to see you again soon. But in lieu of that, for the time being, we are working on our summer activities. We don't know exactly what playground's going to look like, but we're positive it's not going to look like a normal playground season. So we're trying to be innovative and creative to keep you all engaged. And to that end, we're working with other departments in the county and in the city to provide activities for kids this summer. If it's not going to be in person, at least we can give you something to take home and do with your family or do with your siblings. Some of you may have noticed that the basketball rooms are down in the city right now. We did that in an effort to protect kids in our parks. We saw like large groups of kids gathering to play basketball while we were supposed to be social distancing. So we hope that some of those rooms will go up soon. We're working towards that goal once the federal, state, local mandates come down and give us some further direction.
I want to pull up an image just really to magnify, the impact that you are having on our food system. A lot of times when we think about Reading Rec, we think about the physical activities. We take it for granted, I think sometimes, that a lot of times, that is one of the places where our kids are receiving their nourishment, and sometimes they're not receiving it at home. And so I think it's truly phenomenal that the focus right now is on food access, because too often we know directly that, that's a big concern right now. There are a lot of kids who, are wondering, and parents, where are meals coming from? How are we going to make sure that we can eat? So I just want to thank you for sharing this with us. There's a beautiful picture here, but I think the number that really speaks to me is the fact that it's 35,303 meals and snacks to date. Now, this is to date, right? This is kind of where we are right now.
This is through yesterday, and that's 35,303 meals and 35,303 snacks. So they're actually doubled. But a lot of kids that we're serving at 9 locations throughout the city right now. And we normally have a food program, so we're not doing anything that we normally wouldn't do. We've just expanded our outreach.
So in expanding that outreach, what does that look like for you? What resources are you using? How is the staff working with that? And how are people receiving this information? Now, obviously, people are showing up, right? So how are they getting there? Is it mainly on foot? Just some questions that come to mind.
So we have locations throughout the city. We have 3 that the Reading Rec operates directly, which is City Park, 11th and Pike, and 3rd and Spruce. And then we also provide meals to 6 Olivet Boys and Girls sites, which are distributed at their sites throughout the week. And many of the sites, they're different depending on the setup, where 11th and Pike is a lot of pedestrian traffic. 3rd and Spruce, people are able to drive cars and pull up right in front of the building and get meals. The pantry boxes have been our biggest change. That's not something we normally do. Our gymnasiums right now at both of our rec centers are set up as food banks, and we have been packing our own boxes for over 7 weeks and providing meals, providing those pantry boxes to families in the community. So that's something that we normally, we don't do, but we're doing that to help out our neighborhoods. We've had great assistance really from all kinds of organizations helping harvest, Herculean effort really. Jay Worrell and his crew are just doing an amazing job right now distributing food. We're getting all the pantry box food from Helping Harvest. The Reading School District is also handing out breakfast and lunches every day. And they have been responsible for the flyer that actually lets everybody know where all those meal locations are, the pantry box locations. And that flyer is up on our Facebook page. The school district distributes it. We have them physical copies at our sites. So.
Yeah,
that's we're all working together.
Absolutely, something we've been sharing often too. That flyer with all of the different locations, just the different food access points is kind of how I refer to it, because it is a collaborative effort, and that's one of the most beautiful things that I've seen is out of the difficulties of a situation that we're in comes your shirt, this beautiful, silver lining or rays of sunshine, which brings people together. It unites them in efforts of causes that are just, like making sure that everyone is fed. So I think, making sure that people know how to stay in touch with you. So you said Facebook, so people, are still able to follow through. Some people are all Facebooked out these days, right? Or I know some parents are putting restrictions on how much Facebook time you can have. And But in addition to that, what's important is you're putting out some resources virtually as well, right? So, you know, these kits right. that you're also handing out, you know, you're giving people a multitude of access to different activities and engagements, which is, I think, what we miss the most, and probably you can attest to this. You are basically a very big family you know, of people in our community, and you are not being able to see your family members right now, and they're not being able to see you. And I think of it often that way throughout our city. Our normal everyday engagements and our person-to-person relationships are being challenged right now, and that affects all of us, whether we're seniors, like you said, or parents or kids. All of us need some healthy outlets. So I want to thank you for providing those outlets to us, specifically on food access and making sure that everybody is getting as much food as possible. Anything else you'd like to share with us before you go, Daphne?
Yes, actually. So I just want to give a shout out to our 24 graduating seniors. We have class vice presidents, we have future doctors, we have co-valedictorians, we have a whole slew of kids right now that are graduating from high school and college with distinction, including our first class of girls leadership from way back in 2013 are now graduating from Reading Senior High School and many schools throughout the county. So every day at 1 o'clock, because they're number one, we are spotlighting a senior every single day, and every Saturday we're spotlighting college graduates. So I just want to say congratulations to all those kids who have done just such a phenomenal job and made us so RRC proud. So thank you very much for having me, Lucine, and thank you to everybody, and we hope to see you for some meals, you know?
Thanks, Daphne. Thank you for caring so much about our community and going in every single day. You are definitely one of the people on the front line, and we hope that you stay safe and healthy until we're in yellow, and we can kind of start to resume some of our normal activities. That's right.
I even have a matching mask today, you know.
I mean, who could coordinate better, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. So I encourage everybody to stay in touch in the ways that you can, and just really to utilize to the best of your ability these programs and resources that are coming out through the Rec Commission. Moving forward, I do always like to share some very basic and important information that I have, and you know, things that we like to repeat over and over again, just to make sure that people truly are getting the very basic information that is out there that is important. And you know, one of the most recent activities that we had to keep people engaged and really feeling hopeful. You know, again, a lot of times we say, you know, we focus on don't do this and don't do that and stay at home. And, you know, that can become really cumbersome. And so one thing that we have here is just a little update on the Victory Garden Initiative. This was a task force that I commissioned to come together, and we were learning about the task force. And yesterday, on Monday, it launched. So we were distributing these Victory Garden containers to everybody who had signed up in the city of Reading, and initially started out as District 1. And we actually had some additional people sign up, not in District 1, people who lived in the city, people who lived in the county. And we were just really happy to share with them our Cultivating Community project. So I did want to recognize and thank all of the different departments in the city of Reading. So very quickly, I wanted to thank our Public Works Department and the street team specifically, the police and the traffic department, the Citizen Service Center, and the law office, also the Community Development Department, the mayor and his administrative team, and the clerk's office, because all of them came together in supporting us to be able to provide this project for the community. And so you can see here, there's we are on 5th and Penn, one of the properties that belong to the city of Reading. And we have our tent out there and from support of the Downtown Improvement District Authority. And the ambassador was there with us, that's Sam in the picture in the red. They make sure that they're keeping our downtown safe, clean, and green. We also had support from the Penn Street Market. They gave us little bags in hopes that they're gonna be able to open in some variation of the farmer's market on that block this summer on June 4th. But you'll see we had our tables out there and we had our containers. And to the right, you'll see that we have our containers close up and personal. Our containers were designed and fabricated by DS Smith, which is a company located in District 1. And our plants were grown and donated to us. Mostly by the Master Gardeners from the Berks County Extension Program. And then we actually have Tanya Melendez who signed up as a proud resident and participant of the program of District 1. And maybe later we'll ask her what she got in her box. So just really, again, a positive way to focus on things that we can be doing to cultivate our community, to grow our own food, and to stay in touch. Because we are following our stay-at-home order, which is in effect until June 4th. So a reminder to everybody, even though it's nice outside, we are still operating with our stay-at-home order until June 4th. And all Pennsylvanians are required to wear a mask in public. You will notice if you're starting to go out to different businesses and locations, they have signs. And those signs are saying, if you don't have a mask, you cannot be served or you cannot come in. It's very important because just a reminder that when I wear a mask, my mask is protecting you, right? And your mask is protecting me. So make sure that you have a mask and you're wearing it to reduce the mitigation of community spread. If you have general questions for the city of Reading, you can contact the Citizen Service Center. We are open. We are operating as your government body, your elected officials, the city and the administration. Even though City Hall is closed, we are still open, and you can call us at 877-727-3234. What I really want to continue to emphasize is that we are working in tandem with the county to make sure that the latest information on COVID-19 and all the emergency planning and resources and services that you need can be found through the Berks County COVID-19 Help Center. This is very important. It's important to make sure that this information is valid and coming from the same source. So you can email your questions to COVID@countyofberks.com. You can call them 610-320-6150. You can also check in with them. They're open 7 days a week from 8 a.m. to 7 p.m. And so you can find a lot of information at their website, berksdes.com. Also, because we're home and because a lot of us are isolated and we can't be with our loved ones and our families and friends, especially when we just celebrated Mother's Day, we've celebrated holidays and graduations and milestones and just in general, we just can't be together. And that's very hard. It's hard on all of us. And I want you to know that it's okay. And if at any time you feel like you need the support, pick up the phone and give somebody that you love or that you haven't talked to in a while a phone call. If you need social services and supports that our county provides, you can pick up the phone and dial 211. I want everybody to know that you aren't alone, even though we're not together. And so at any time, please make sure to reach out, check on your neighbors, check on your family, your friends, and your loved ones. Doing things like this, our community check-ins, very important right now. We have the ability to use platforms virtually, our phones, our internet, and it gives us the ability to stay together and to keep each other uplifted and inspired during this difficult time. A reminder too, that if you are a business owner, there are so many resources out there and so much information to sort through. And what I found is the best place to go is really the Pennsylvania Department of Community and Economic Development. That's really getting it from the horse's mouth. That's what the state has for you. There certainly are lending entities locally that are providing information. A great source also is the Greater Reading Chamber Alliance. They are doing a very good job of outreach. I know specifically in our 18th ward, we have Scott Case, who is helping to coordinate and facilitate on behalf of the 18th Ward Business Association. And so I urge you to just reach in, reach out, check in to see what it is that we need. What information can we share? And just even updates too, sometimes just questions, if you're a local business owner, are you considering opening up? How are you doing this takeout? How are you putting the plexiglass up? How are you managing orders? All of those things are really important to dialogue around right now. We might get into talking about some of that a little bit later in our program too. But what I'd like to do is move on to our next guest, because she's a very special person. She's doing so many different things. It's very hard to keep up with her. I tribute to some of the heroes in our community. You may not see all the time. You may not know them, but really a lot of the work and the wonderful programs and the things that we see are getting accomplished by these inspired community leaders. People who just can't sit back and wait for the world to change. They are actually tackling change themselves. And so I'd like to introduce my next guest. This is Tanya Melendez. And I hope Tanya's still with us. Are you there, Tanya?
Yes, ma'am. I'm right here.
So what do you have behind you? Where are you joining us from?
This used to be my office where actual adult work happened. It turns into a schoolroom now. There's schoolwork everywhere, because I'm also a homeschool teacher now.
And who are you homeschooling?
My daughter, she's 6 years old. A six-year-old.
Yes, I know. And we could just spend the next hour talking about those experiences. I won't say challenges, because I think it's just there. We're experiencing my experiences with a two-year-old, right? But what's important to point out here is that your office / home / school is in District 1, and we live two blocks away from each other. A lot of the work that you do revolves around that and revolves around the 18th Ward. So first, tell me what you've been noticing in the neighborhood. What are you seeing? Are you seeing people? Are you not seeing people? What's it like?
I've seen a lot of neighbors that I've never seen before walking around, walking dogs that I've never seen before, a lot less kids. And I haven't seen many of the elderly, so we try to check in. A couple of the neighbors and I call each other, and we go and check in on them at least once a week. But a lot of newer people, like I guess like 3-4 blocks away, they're getting some exercise, and they're making all the way down to our block and then turning around and going back up. A lot more yard work. Yeah. I guess we all want to get out of the house and play outside, so this is the best that we can do. But kids are finding ways to keep entertained and maintain the rules. I mean, my daughter, for one, keeps having races in our side of the street with the neighbor across the street. So they're like, ready, set, go, and they run, and I beat you, and then they run back. Or flashlight tag at nighttime. I mean, especially my kid, she's one kid, single parent, one child. So for her, there's only so much she can play with mom. There's only so many board games she wants to play. And I'm one of those parents that doesn't do a lot of TV or screen time. And so for her, well, she plays very well by herself, but at some point she's like, I need to play with other kids. Mm-hmm. We've even had a couple of play dates via Zoom where literally the other kid has the same thing in front and she has in front of her, and they'll spend an hour just playing.
Yeah, we finding that we have to be creative around the ways that we are engaging our children, and in safe ways, because like you said, a lot of us are monitoring screen time and TV, and so what do we do otherwise? And how do we engage them in virtual play dates, like you said, as the new norm, you know, we're doing that too. And I vowed I would never allow my two-year-old to, you know, use a laptop and an iPad and do these things, but there we are, because the other part of it is that isolation that we're talking about. You know, they're so accustomed to being with other people, you know, their age and, you know, with their friends. And, you know, if we're out walking in the park, I think one of the things I find really heartbreaking is when we go for our walks, I have to say, stay here, don't go there, don't touch the dog, don't say hi, don't give anyone a hug. And that's really heartbreaking. That's really hard to have to say that to our children right now, and that they're growing up with that in fear. So trying to normalize, I love the idea of, you know, in tandem on two sides of the street, doing the racing and you know, some of those things that then, you know, the exploration and when we can kind of go back to normal. I know my son can't wait to go back to Brookline. That's the park that we always go to. We can walk there, and you know, it's a beautiful city park that we have. It's his favorite. He misses the slides, he misses the swings, and you know, we don't have that in our backyard. And you know, so explaining things like that to our kids are really tough, but I know you're doing a really good job, and I commend you, because no matter what age they are right now, it is definitely a challenge for all of us. And, you know, so being outside, at least the weather's changing, a lot of yard work. I have to say, our neighborhoods are looking really beautiful, and, you know, maybe it's because we have more time. You know, then we have to do something, maybe because we're home more, we notice and we're embarrassed, like, oh my gosh, I can't believe that I did take care of that. You know, it's been on my list for a couple of years now. So I'm seeing a lot of pride, neighborhood pride and stewardship, when I'm out and taking my walks and driving through, and I love to see it.
I did too. It's been, even, I mean, when I'm not on the 18th ward, I'm definitely in the District 1 because of the business. I run Tropical Bakery on 9th and Binghamton, family owned and operated since 1992. Can you believe that?
Yes. It was a good year.
I know, but it still is like, wow, 1992. So even, you know, south side of Reading, which has, you know, the lovely reputation that it's always had, it's been same type of community things happening. You were talking earlier about food sources and resources. And I've heard so many of the neighbors, since our place tends to be a meeting and gathering place, mm-hmm. and now it can't be. So there's a lot of people like outside, sort of talking across the street and things like that. Mm-hmm. So I hear a lot more of, hey, did you get all the food you needed? Because I know they're going to be giving out food that place tomorrow at that time. Right. Or they're sharing boxes of food. Mm-hmm. This, even in the South Side, I've seen the change, the outside taking care of their property or just spending time outside, and the kids the same. It's like, can't let them run around and play, but you see them in the porch talking to the other kids. So there's a lot of that happening. Business-wise, well, that's a whole other story.
Well, maybe what we'll do is have you come on and talk specifically about the business. I think it would be neat to do an episode just, you know, from that business perspective a little bit. Too often I had been hearing, I won't let my kids play outside. You know, in the South Side, I'm worried, it's dangerous, the cars are going too fast, I don't know my neighbors, I'm worried. And maybe perhaps, again, being optimistic, this is one of the things that the outbreak has brought to us, the ability to re-engage with our neighbors, and to know them, and to say, you know what, my kids got to go outside. Like, they can't stay inside all the time. And so you're just going to have to honor and respect that space. And, you know, each other as neighbors. I think that because our community is so transient, we've started to get away from things like that and knowing your neighbors. If somebody moves in, you know, greeting them and saying, hi, what do you need? I live there, whatever, you know. Helping each other, you know, do little tasks, taking the trash out. And, you know, that's kind of where a lot of the concept of cultivating community comes from. It's not just about growing a garden. You know, it's about really investing and growing the sentiment around your, who are your neighbors? What block do you live on? You know, how do you feel about that? And is that truly how you want your neighborhood to be? Like, you know, make it exactly how you want it to be. Because our neighborhoods are different, right? Like, and that the diversity around our neighborhoods and the people who live in them I think is the best gift of all to make up the vibrant city that we have. So, you know, always encouraging people, like you said, to just check on each other and engage with each other a little bit more is important. So how are you doing that? Because I think I could think of like three or four different efforts that you've been involved with and getting the community engaged right now, getting people together around different projects. So let's talk about some of them.
So there's a video initiative, the COVID information initiative, which we have a series of videos running around Facebook and YouTube and all that, informing people in English and Spanish, just encouraging people to stay healthy, stay safe, to follow rules and to keep exercising. Also with the library boxes, we are using them as mini pantries. Actually today I'm gonna go put some baby food and baby items in them today. I have a donation that was given, so I'm going to go put them out there. And then I'm still putting books out there. I'm just, you know, either wrapping them in saran wrap type things or putting them in sandwich bags. Mm-hmm. So everybody feels comfortable, you know, grabbing one and taking it home and opening it. And so trying to discourage, you know, hands on all the items.
Mm-hmm.
You have to look at the books to see which one you're going to take. You're not going to take all of them. So I'm trying to do that. What else? putting together some bags to give away with some items with masks and things like that in the near future. Whatever we can do to help, whatever I can do to help, I'm there.
Yeah, let's talk about, I mean, some of them are ongoing. So you were the one to spearhead these 18th Wonder Free Little Libraries. And then in the interim of books, have also added the pantry items. I think that's, you know, brilliant. It's just such an easy, quick way to utilize something that's already going on and enhance it to what the community needs right now. You know, the videos were phenomenal. I'm seeing a lot of airplay and time for those. How do we find them? Just on YouTube? Is that the easiest? Or maybe through Facebook?
Any of the platforms that have the 18th Wonder Improvement Association has them all. So whether it's the Facebook for the 18th Wonder Improvement Association, the YouTube, the Twitter, they all have them. And the website, which is 18thward.com or 18thward.org, which sent you to the Business Association, mm-hmm. they're cross-referenced anyway. So either one of them, you can get to the videos. Also, the 18th Wonder Business Alliance, they're doing a lot of information, particularly to our area, what businesses are open, what if they're having takeout only, if they're opening just for a special location. And it's all over their Facebook and it's all over their website. So if you're interested in like takeout or, you know, you want to buy your kid a big birthday cake and everything is closed and where can I go? There's right. a lot of information like that. As far as the Neighborhood Alliance, which is me, we're trying to get as much information to the neighborhood as we can about what's happening, what's going on, and what we can do to help. And any questions that we're getting, we're just referring them to the right person, working as a, I guess, like a pathway of information to the mm-hmm. best of our abilities.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for the Victory Gardens, I think I posted it on our Facebook, and I personally got like 10 emails, and I was like, this is how you're going to get them, and this is what they're doing. So, you know, and I know that one of them isn't a District 1 person, but I was like, here you go. It is what it is. As much information as we can share, we're sharing. And personally, whatever I can do to help, I try and I do. But, you know, there's a lot of hats and a lot of roles, but all you can do is help. I've yeah. never believed in complaining. Doesn't do anything but annoy other people and give you a headache. So it's just work. What can we do to work?
I'm going to quote you on that. I can't thank you enough because, you know, we don't have to do any of it, but we are. And you're one of the people leading the charge. And I very much appreciate you and what you're doing and all the hats that you're wearing right now. You're inspiring a lot of people. And so keep up the good work. Let us know how we can continue to help you in everything that you're doing, including carrying out, you know, the delicious pastries that you have. That's a place where you can get a cake, right? So we hope that you will continue to stay in touch with you, and you know, talk, maybe bring you back to talk about the businesses and kind of that perspective. And stay safe, and keep that lovely 9-year-old as busy as possible. And we'll talk to you soon. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for giving us a forum. Bye.
Bye. I can't tell people enough how impressed I've been with the outpouring of you know, Tanya says it's just work, you know, you just do it, you know, and Daphne, you know, she thinks she's doing her job, and it's just that she's doing her job, but each and every one of the individuals that we talk to and we see are doing so much more. And, you know, I always appreciate the feedback and the compliments, but really it's to all of us and to each of us. The other day I read a book to the community. We did a story time, and that was last week's community check-in. And it was this beautiful story about Sophia Valdez and Future Prez, and this little girl who comes across a landfill, and she decides that it has to become a park, and her journey as to how to take that idea and how to create a beautiful park and involve the community. It was just very touching. And I see that happening and resonating, that story, in almost each and every one of us. So I want to thank you for all of that. A few more slides before we move to our next guest, which is such an important representative of the city of Reading, because again, there, you know, is so much work being done right now. It's a difficult time for all of us, and you know, it is important not to just do our jobs, but to do our jobs. And I think this is one of the things that we're going to talk about here, but I do just want to share my screen momentarily and remind people that, you know, right now it's also census time. So if there's anything that you could be doing right now, it is to complete the census. Everybody in Berks counts. And I think that's the most important information that you can remember. And when you speak with people, your neighbors, your friends, your family, reminding them that the census is happening right now, and it is very significant for our community. The impact is huge, over $2,000 per person. The census counts every living person in the United States. So while you are home, please complete your 2020 census. You can do it over the phone. You can do it online. If you know, you can do it via mail. It takes less than 5 minutes, and it is so critical and important to fill out the census information because it really provides the funding that we need to support our community. A reminder too that we have had some concerns about loitering. Tanya was describing how her location in the south of Penn is a community gathering place, but right now we have a stay-at-home order in effect, and so you cannot be gathering in public places. Loitering is exactly the opposite of what you should be doing. Obstructing public places by standing together and remaining idly in one location, lingering around and standing around with others, is not acceptable, and it is enforceable. We want to make sure that it's not us having to enforce you to follow the rules. Residents are not allowed to loiter, and so if you do see this happening, you can call and report loitering from a non-emergency number at 610-655-6116, but stay safe. Please do not gather together. This is the wrong time to be doing that. I know the weather is nice. I know you miss your family and friends, but we need to stay at home. Also, a great way to stay in touch with the community and the city is through that Reading iRequest app. And so just a reminder, if you haven't downloaded this application on your smartphone or device, you can submit requests to the city directly through iRequest and also get reverse notifications when things are being worked on. We use this for the Victory Container Garden. We use this for different projects, for the street sweeping. It's a great communication tool from us to you and from you to us. So please remember to continue to use this and to download it at your convenience. So I'm going to introduce my guest, who's been waiting very patiently. Joining us is the director of the Community Development Department for the City of Reading, and that is Mr. Jamal Abodalo. Jamal, are you still with us?
I am. How are you, Lucine?
I'm doing very well. Thank you very much for joining us today. I know you probably have so many things going on right now in your department.
Yes, we do. Actually, thank you very much for hosting me. I really appreciate that. I take this opportunity to share with all our viewers of how great we are doing in the city, considering the circumstances that we are in right now, and how young is the administration. We feel like we jumped on a treadmill and somebody turned the switch on and we start running at 100 miles an hour. But we are up to the task and we're up to the challenge. So we're taking the COVID situation and be able to make the best out of it and reach out to so many entities, so many residents, and reach out to so many organizations to offer our help and to offer our assistance. And how can we be actually an ambassadors to our community? Community development, as you know, has several operations to it. It's economic development is the crown that we are all trying to ebb up to and support in there. But it's supported by property maintenance, zoning, historic, planning, building and trades, the community development programs that we have, reaching out to end homelessness, rapid housing. All of these are programs that actually filter into the community development. So in this time, what we are trying to do, and one of the things that we would like to emphasize on, since everybody is staying at home and they are stir crazy and they are really trying to do and entertain themselves with something useful in there, is that we are trying to actually communicate with our residents and with our business owners to find out about how we would be able to help and assist in that regard. So for instance, one of the programs that we have and that's being scheduled, and actually we use the iRequest for that application, is that we notified all the receivers of the iRequest that we have the Quality of Life program. And the Quality of Life program is one of the things that we're trying to do, where we are trying to send our property maintenance inspectors. I don't like to use the term inspectors. I really would like to use educators, ambassadors in there, because we're not there to set a tone of that we are enforcing and we're sending citations and we want to take it to the magistrate. That is not exactly what we're trying to do. What we are really trying to do are a few things that will help our community to prosper and be healthier and be a better community altogether. So when we see trash in thrown in there, we will probably need to know how we can help with that program, how we would be able to reach out to the property owner and say, by the way, trash day is such and such day. You need to contain the trash containers in a certain place. You need to keep them in bags and be able to avoid any other contaminations that could be created, for considering that we are still in the red zone and we have a lot of potentials of having more viruses, not only the coronavirus but other viruses that simulates from accumulated trash. And we're trying to do something like that, weeds and issues of that nature. We'll also try to help. The property maintenance department is really a very essential department for us to now reach out to the community and tell them that we are here to help you. We are here to listen to you, to hear what you are doing, and in a way, how can we be able to service you? The other component of that is the building and trade, which is basically now construction is open as of May 1st. So there are a lot of people who would like to finish their project, finish that kitchen, renovate that bathroom. So we're trying to also help homeowners to expedite the process of securing their building permits and getting it. So in these two areas itself, what we're trying to say is that reach out to us. We would like to help you. would like, we are available. I am available. You can reach out to me, and I can promise you that if there are any delays, we'll just find out where the delays are stuck, and we'll process this approach and make sure that you get your permits or you get your answers to whatever you need an answer for in a timely manner, so that we can be of an assistance and service you. This is our department. The community department is of service to all of us in there. Part of the excitement too is actually what we are trying to do in other areas in there. Like, for instance, Lucene, you are a member of the Reading Downtown Improvement District. And that is the district that we would like to bring in and invite many commercial facilities and headquarters that will be able to. Before the coronavirus, there was a bank that actually wanted to put a call center and a headquarter in our area in here. And obviously, we will resume these conversation discussion with them after the COVID-19 is lifted, or at least moved into the yellow phase, and we can move on a little bit freely. There are so many developments that are going on in our area, and we've had several meetings, Zoom meetings with developers that they are really, really ready to bring in high-end homes, mixed use of commercial facilities, so that we can bring all of this. And why is that all important to us? It's important because we can start attracting more of the industry that we really desire. Because a lot of us, for instance, at this time are limited with what we can do and with the choices we have. And if we need to do something out of the order, we probably have to drive to Allentown, to Lancaster, to Philadelphia, King of Prussia. We would like to make our city a whole city that you don't have to drive there. It's all available for you in your area here. It's a matter of 10, 15 minute drive, and you can enjoy it all together within our city. So our city will be encompassing of all, for everybody and anybody to enjoy whatever they would like to have it within the boundaries of a beautiful city that is trying to. So that is the economic development part. But also another part of the economic development is also we need to remember that there are a lot of efforts trying to happen right now. For instance, the Alvernia University bringing in College Town. That is a commitment all of itself to make sure that we are going to have engineering as well as business administration in our area. These are two phenomenal aspects of that. Just think about it, that if we have the right engineering field, then carpenter technology will hire from there. Deca batteries will hire from there. That, so we are creating the field for our residents, for our students to actually be educated in here and also be hired in our area. So we don't have to seek a different place to go. And it is very disheartening as a father myself, when I educate my kids in Berks County, and then when they graduate, they have to go somewhere else in search of a better job. Would it be much better for them to be in our area here?
I agree with you. I know that I've personally faced that. I chose to do my master's degree at Alvernia University, and I have been such a supporter, trying to lead them through and navigate the different processes of creating that college town campus downtown. Even though I'm lucky enough to have them in District 1, where we call that the campus on the hill, I've tried to help facilitate and navigate for that revitalization and development that you're talking about, that community and economic development, the potential that this project has and will impact on us as a community, because the job offerings are strong in Harrisburg or in Philadelphia. Or, but I live here, my family is here, and I enjoy being here. And so I, don't want to leave. And we don't want to experience what, we've heard referred to as the brain drain. And if we are lucky enough to have institutions just like Alvernia, Albright, you know, Penn State, RAC, you know, and even Kutztown, all at our fingertips. How do we engage these institutions to invest in our urban core so that we are reinvesting then in them? You know, those are all institutions that can employ and educate and help stimulate the demographics of our community holistically, right? And that's what we want. You know, we want to be building the future of Greater Reading for the generations to come, not just for me. I mean, look, I would love to, you know, walk or ride my bike to the core of our beautiful city and, you know, dine in many international flavored restaurants mm-hmm. and go see, you know, independent films and take a walk on the riverfront. And, you know, the truth of it is I can do that. And I don't know if people realize, but we should build on that critical mass so that it's inevitable. And so when people say, oh, it's Friday night or there's a special occasion, mm-hmm. let's go to the Himalayan in Lancaster, you know, let's go to the Blue Elephant in Pottstown. I've been there. I love those places. But you know what? I want to invest in my city and I want to be able to do it right in my own neighborhood. And I think that's part of the conversations that we are all starting to have together, especially with you and your leadership of the Department of Community Development. You said it perfectly. You're an ambassador. You are ambassadors of, you know, bringing the best and cultivating the best for our Greater Reading. And that's how I see it. So, you know, to date, I've really enjoyed working with you on some different projects that are coming out. Let's talk about one of the big ones that you're getting ready to release. Let's talk about how you are supporting our small business owners in the city of Reading.
Certainly, we'll be more than happy to. Actually, the process has already started, the very first part of it in there. And I thank you, Lucille, for supporting that this ordinance and this resolution, as well as the city council. We have actually created a fund, which is about $1 million fund. Okay, and that is actually from operating costs and expenses within the city of Reading. In another sense, this is not something that we basically waited for the CARE Act. This is the CARE Act, and the stimulus from the CARE Act is a totally different mission. We will be talking about that in a few weeks, and hopefully you will host me again so we can talk about the restart of the city of Reading. But before we start about the restart of the city of Reading, let's talk about the small and very small business owners that we have. And this is kind of like, it sits very close to me here, because what I have seen in the $2.2 trillion package that the federal government disseminated in there, that a lot of the big companies benefited from that. But the small little mom and pop guys did not really have a chance to even apply in there, and they didn't know how to apply. So with the administration, with the support of Mayor Moran, as well as the city council, and the managing director, we actually reached an agreement with Community First Bank, and Community First Fund, I'm sorry, it's not a bank, it's a fund in there. And basically what we are going to do on May 27th, and please keep that date in there. If you have a pencil or paper, write this down in there. May 27th is when the application will start, okay? And at the same time, it will close sometimes around June 10th. In that time, you will be able to apply as a small business owner. And it's a very simple process, okay? And the loan is forgivable loan if you can actually follow the guidelines that we provided for the program. So let's talk about the program first, and then we'll talk about the guidelines. The program itself has three tiers. Remember, this is something, a program to help businesses to keep just the door open in there. So if a business revenue is up to $250,000, they qualify to $200 to $2,500. Okay, if the business makes between $250,000 to $500,000, they qualify for $5,000. If they make over $500,000 and less than $1 million, they qualify for $7,500. No nonprofit organizations are not in this program. Businesses over $1 million revenue, they are not also in this program altogether. So how do you get this loan, and we call it forgivable loan? What happens is that actually through Community First Fund, you'll be able to apply. We will have a link on our website. I'm going to give you the name of a person who is actually right now taking names and phone numbers and preparing a list of who they are. And I would like you to reach out to Ms. Rafaela Lopez in our office in here. And I believe her phone number is 610-655-6412. I will double check on that and I'll let you know if I memorize it correctly or not. And Ms. Lopez will take your information. So the loan itself, once you apply it, the bank will basically look at the legitimacy of the business itself. How many years of business have you filed your tax returns? Basically, what were your trend of business before the COVID-19 in there? And at that point in time, you will be able to get a loan based on your revenue. This loan, if it's paid towards keeping the doors open, if it's kept for rent, utilities, and anything of that nature, paid an employee for being there, that loan, once it's documented, it will be actually forgiven. Okay, but let's say there is a component of that loan that you had to do something that is very, very, very necessary to the operation, but it's not classified under these categories itself. The loan is actually paid back at 1% over 2 years. So really, in all respects in there, what we're trying to do is that we're going to try to give you a stimulus, an infusion of cash in order mm-hmm. to keep you going in there, and saying that we understand that at a tough time like this, we need to remember our neighbors. We need to remember the small business owners. We need to stand by them and support them in that regard. And that is basically what we'll be launching. This city council will vote in this on May 26th, and it will the applications will be available on April 27th. Right now, we are actually conducting dry run between us and Community First Fund in there. We've received the application. The application is not live, but we are troubleshooting it, and we're trying to see how we can bring it in so that when we have the number of phone calls and the number of inquiries, we will be able to handle that in a timely manner. Because the process itself, from what I was told, it's a very simple process. You apply, you fulfill all these applications there, and you meet all the requirements, your approval will be probably granted within 24 hours. And then at a certain point in time, I believe sometimes end of June, where the funds will be dispersed.
And that is such a very quick turnaround. I know that our local businesses, some of the business owners that I've spoken to, may or may not have tried to participate in some of the federal, support that was out there. They might not have even made it. They didn't hear back from anybody. They had difficulties. So to do this on a micro local level with lending and potentially forgivable lending is a lifeline that our businesses need. And as much speculation is out there in terms of, did we do it the right way? Did we provide the support? This is one way to say we are still trying. And we are absolutely trying to invest in the very fabric of our community and economy. When we look at our local business owners, they live here, their families are here, their businesses are here, and the repercussions of not being able to support them and for them in their viability of their business and the sustainability of that is beyond detrimental to our community. Absolutely. So I'm so pleased. I look forward on the 26th to moving that forward, and then next day getting those applications in. We'll make sure to get the word out as much as possible. Thank you for sharing the phone number. Also, I believe people will be able to be redirected from the city's website directly to Community First Fund. having people being able to talk about it. Certainly people can reach out to me and I will direct them to you. So what's most important is we get as many people informed about this and hopefully to consider then if it's right for them. And I hope that people will take advantage of this. There's so many more things to talk about specifically around community development. And one of the things I touched on earlier, and just maybe quickly you can say a little bit, is the money that comes to support our community from the census. Do you just want to take a minute or two to talk about how important and why it's so important for everybody to be counted?
Actually, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity, Lucine, to talk about this, because it's really, really imperative, very, very essential for us. And I will talk to our viewers in a way that it touches everyone's heart on this point in time, because we are all hearing about the unemployment rate and how unemployment is rampant, and it is worse than the Great Depression back in the 1920s. And there, one of the things that we all see as people who would have to live and based on money coming into our to our family. When one of the providers of the family, the husband, the wife, spouses loses their income, so that is a drop in income itself. And as a result of that, as a family, we'll try to strategize on how we are going to deal with the deficit and what are the things that we have to do without in order to just survive until our partners pick up a job and bring in another their income. The same thing applies with the city. It's exactly in the same way. With the census itself, right now, our populations, it's estimated based on the 2010, we are in the neighborhood of about 60, 65,000 people within the city. But our unconfirmed number of that is we are about 40,000 more. We are about 110, maybe 115. And that is the unconfirmed number. So now let's do the math very quickly. For every person, we're going to receive $2,100. Every person, that is every person, young, middle age, older age, each and every one of them will get it. Now, if we take that $2,100 and multiply this by 40,000, that's approximately about $1 billion. Now, can you imagine if you and a homeowner that your budget doubled, your income has doubled, what can you do with that? It's the same thing with the city. What can we do if our budget, in fact, doubled and we have it there? We will have better roads. We'll have better houses. We'll have better schools. We will have better, we'll have better commercial facilities. We'll have better industries. Industries will flock in here simply because they know that there are means and facilities for it, for them to prosper. So it is very important for us to basically take the Census 2020 very serious and take about 5 minutes of all. But let me address another matter. And this matter is very important, and allow me to address it in such a way. And that is basically, to the contrary of what the myth is saying, that this information, once you've given them your race, once you've given them your location, it's going to be taken into different federal organizations, and it might backfire on us, and it might hurt the person. That is not the case at all. This information is confidential and this information is safe. So when you provide information about your family, actually it does not reach out to that level of this in there. And let me say that we will not be prosecuted if we provided this information. And I would like to say this sincerely to everyone listening and our viewer all together, that this information is important for us because it will make our life better. But this is not, and we will not endanger your life. And for that particular reason, we try to reach out to a lot of our religious leaders so that they can talk to the pressures, because they trust in that. They trust that they will be able to. And we would like to build that trust bridge in there so that please go and register. You can register online, you can register your phone, or you probably by now you have received the mail in there. In one way or another, just register, provide the information, and the city is hurrying. just to close in that and just want to let you know of where we stand in comparison to other places in there surrounding us in Berks County and Lancaster or Allentown and what have you. We are in the 30 to 40 percentile, and most of our areas are actually in the 30 percentile. The national average is about 57. So we're dragging about 25% behind. When comparison to other areas like in Berks County, in some areas we're dragging about 15%. And why is that? Because we need to reach out and vote and register. Please help us to help you.
Thank you, Jamal. I think that is probably one of the most important messages we can get out today. We are just about out of time, unfortunately, and we didn't even get to touch on a few of the other things that we had discussed talking about. So that means you're going to have to promise me that you will come back and that we can continue updating everybody on behalf of the point of view and the role of community development. We, you know, will continue to talk about, I think what's really important is getting a cohesive, collaborative vision of our city. And, you know, that means everybody involved. What does this city look like in its best version to you and to me? And then to really be able to navigate through that. I know the Community Development Department will be playing a very big role in that as we move towards strategic planning, comprehensive planning, to create that vision in solidarity of really revitalizing and bringing our city to the very best version of itself. And I can't wait to do that with you. And I'm so glad that you are part of our team now with the city.
Thank you.
I look forward to having you on again to continuing this conversation. And in the meantime, thank you for going to work every day, to going into City Hall, to putting yourself at risk, to ensure that this important work that you're doing and all of your staff and all of your team members are doing
to
keep all of us safe. That's right. Yes, we'll have to get you one that is a little more fashionable, I think, to match, you know, when you go into work, whatever you're going to wear. But again, all joking aside, please be safe, stay safe. I wish
Thank
that to your family as well. And we'll have you on again sooner than later.
Pleasure being with you. Thank you very much.
So we very quickly have gone through our hour of community check-in. Really look forward to this opportunity every week. I appreciate when you reach out to me, when you share your questions and concerns with me, whether that's through email, through Facebook, through, you know, reaching out to the clerk's office at City Council, or, you know, maybe even just seeing me if I'm out and about walking around in the neighborhood and throughout the district. I just want to remind everybody to stop the spread, to stay at home, to be vigilant in protecting yourselves and your loved ones during this outbreak period. Keep informed, stay in tune with the governor and how he is mitigating this process and moving us as Berks County in the southeast region of the state to yellow so that we can try to begin to safely enjoy and support our businesses and our community the summer that's just ahead of us. So I wish you safety happiness until we meet again, which will be next week. And until then, keep in touch, share your stories, and I'll talk to you soon.